got?
Cold Steel Recon Scout.
Coming to you with, finally, my review on the Cold Steel Recon Scout. Tabletop review, you guys have seen it in action a number of times. I've had this knife now, or I've been an owner of a Recon Scout now for a little over 2.5 years. And I actually had one break on me. And I say break, and I'll roll in the video of kind of when it happened. It was on that Autobahn adventure with my best buddy Chris. In the snow, in some cooler temperatures, but not cold, and really what broke on it, and it didn't really break, it just came loose and you could hear it sort of twanging around, was the finger guard. And I've spoken to this before, many times before, and I apologize again for the glare. I do not like finger guards on my wilderness knives, and I would rather run from a knife fight and never need a finger guard. Bottom finger guards I'm cool with. Or flare-outs, or whatever you want to call them. But I do not like a finger guard on the top for the very reason that it just wrecks my baton if I'm doing any woodworking or if I'm splitting any logs in the great outdoors. But let's get down to it. I have dubbed this knife my Dirty Diana, and music appropriate from the King of Pop himself. And this knife is one of my favorites for outdoor use. This, clearly just looking at it, you can tell that it is designed as a tactical, I guess, if you want to use that word. I'm growing to dislike that word more and more every day. But a combat survival knife, if you want to call it that. Again, you've got the finger guard. You've got plenty of weight, which I'll talk to in a minute. Plenty of reach. And look at the swedge on this. Boy, that would be deadly. It comes unsharpened out of the box, but you could sharpen that up and that would just be a ruthless fighting knife. Again, not my style. I won't even speak to it as I have no experience in that, and I'm thankful for that. But in its role as a survival knife, this has become one of my favorites, and I'll speak to why. Let's discuss the steel first. This is the newer version, and this was sent to me after I sent it back to Cold Steel. Very good. From my experience, very good customer service. Sent it back to me, no questions asked. Brand new knife, no questions asked. Very quick as well. But this is the SK5, the steel, high carbon steel. From what I read and understand, and you guys know I'm not a metallurgy? I'm not an expert in steels. I know enough to be dangerous, but from what I understand, this steel, the SK5, is very close to a 1080, 1090 steel. So high carbon steel, either way, it's going to hold a good edge. You can put a really good edge on it. It's going to hold a good edge, be nice and easy to sharpen in the field for you, which I always appreciate. But it will rust on you, so you want to keep it well oiled. You can see some of the oil. There, I must have over-oiled it the last time. But keep it well-oiled at home and in the field, and it'll always treat you well. You can see the use that I've put on this. I've beaten the trash out of this knife, both this one and the old one. The old one got even more of a beating than this one did. But again, go back and watch some of my recent videos of the field testing of this, and you'll see me smashing this knife about as hard as you can smash a knife in under a realistic scenario. Again, I really don't like this top finger guard because it will mess up your baton, as will this swedge. This knife is brutal on your baton, so just know that going into it, but it's an excellent It's an excellent knife to split wood with, and in that capacity, it is one of the best performing knives for two reasons. One, you got a full flat grind blade, so you've got a wedge shape all the way down, and this is the thickest blade I own. Look at that. It's 5/16, so just over a quarter of an inch thick, which is where it gets its weight from. I know a lot of complaints, and even one that I've sort of levied, is that even though it's a full tang, I wish you had much more of a grip, or at least contour the grip a little bit so it fits your hand better. You've got a total overall length of 12 inches, 5-inch handle, so 7.5 inches on the blade, pretty much a full run all the way through. So you got pretty much 7.5 inches, 7 inches of cutting straight edge, which is awesome. Very sharp out of the box, and you can keep it really sharp again. So a lot of length here on the cutting edge, a lot of cutting surface, and a super strong spine, and super thick full flat grind gives it a real nice wedge, and you can split wood like a champ with this thing. Probably in my estimation, or my guesstimation, to compensate for the added weight of having such a thick knife, what they did was just did sort of a straight post back for the handle. And again, it's plenty big enough. I've got average size hands, so if you have larger size hands, they're still going to fit on that. You've got 5 inches to work with, plenty of real estate. But it doesn't contour your hand very well. So if you're chopping or doing really anything other than just holding it, if you're doing a lot of motion and movement, you will feel a little fatigue in your hand because this does not conform to your hand really whatsoever. It's really straight back. You don't have any bulge coming out here, and you don't have any contour in here. So that's really the only criticism that I would levy, but I'm sure the reason that they did that was for a weight factor. This thing total is well over a pound in terms of weight for the knife. So again, you're going to be forced to make a compromise. If you're going to want maybe you're going to bring this knife in for a day hike, and maybe your SAK as well, and those are going to be your two knives, so you've got a smaller blade knife in your SAK, maybe it's a pocket knife, maybe your EDC, and you're going to bring a bigger blade like this for any woodworking, sheltercraft, firemaking, you know, that'd be a great compromise. But what you're gaining in capacity, you're also gaining in weight. So just a heads up there. But overall, great knife, wonderful job splitting, got a little choil area you can choke up on. If I had my druthers, what I would do is go ahead and take this piece off. I'm sure you can just separate this piece and take it off. Take a look at how this fit, this rubber overmold, how that fit after taking this off. Maybe it would need some silicone in there. And then what I would do is really go ahead and reprofile the edge. If you want to see one of my favorite edges, take a look at my video of the one I just shot of the RC4 by Essie, and they have an awesome edge. That relief cut is backed up enough so you can put a nice thin edge on it. Again, another full flat grind knife just like this one, but it allows you to put a great edge on it because they brought that profile back up, and that's what I would do to this as well. That would really enhance its capabilities as a chopper. And a slicer as well, because you'd be able to thin that edge out even a little bit more than you can on this one here. So that's what I would do. Those are the two modifications that I would make. And if there's one additional modification that I would ask Cold Steel to make, if they're listening and if they care, is to make this a pommel end. If you had a pommel end on this, you'd have a really nice, again, I won't really speak to combat, but, you know, if you needed to have hammering capabilities there, if you hammer with this end, you're going to split it in half, and you're going to have a lot of debris and water, etc., get up in there, and that's not what you want, because you can't take this off to clean underneath it. So you really don't want to be hammering with that, and having those capabilities on the end of a blade like this would really be a nice addition to it. So two modifications I would make, and then one extra one, Cold Steel, if you're listening and if you care. I think that'd be a great addition to the back of this knife, sort of K-bar-esque with that pommel on the end of it. But that would just make for a tremendous knife. Let's get to the sheath. This is one of my favorite sheaths that we have. They call it the Securex sheath, and I really like Kydex and plastic for all the reasons that you may have guessed. It's just much more, it's obviously impervious to the elements, so it's much less maintenance out in the field, a little bit easier to repair if something ever did happen to it. They tend to hold the knife a little bit better, and they don't retain water, which is great on these high carbon knives that are prone to the rust. You can see on this one, the knife fits in very well, holds in very secure. And I mean, you know, again, if you were going to wear this thing in a Molly attachment, you know, you're Superman as far as I'm concerned, because this is a heavy, heavy knife to wear in that capacity. You certainly could, and as you can see, it's got the attachments for it. You've got a couple different carry options with the knife, but you're sort of going to be limited just due to its size. But what you could do is get some of those Maxpedition straps, those Velcro straps, I believe they are, and go ahead and secure them, you know, to your bag or to your straps with that. And that would be a cool way to secure it. Plenty of lanyard holes, plenty of attachment and carry options. Two screw spots for this for your nylon belt carry, which is, please, other manufacturers, take note. It is attached. You do just have one retention strap up here, but that's all that's really necessary due to the fact that it clips in there and holds it well. So again, one of my favorite outdoor knives. As of October, the end of October 2010, you can really get this one, and the prices seem to fluctuate pretty wildly online, but it looks like you're going to be anywhere from about, I don't know, $100 to about $115 or $120 for this blade. This blade is not made in the USA. I believe this is made in Taiwan. There you go. Quality control doesn't seem to be an issue as much as I think maybe just the way it's designed are an issue. And again, not that, you know, woodwork or baton work or splitting logs is the ultimate test for a knife or the only test for a knife. And I think that, you know, because of the way it's designed with these pieces being separate, that the more you bang on this thing and just hammer on this part, and even this part, just maybe due to the harmonics of the wood and the knife as the vibrations send back into the handle, this is going to be prone to come loose. So, you know, again, I'm not going to fault the knife on that one. And if I have previously, let me rescind that. It's really just a function of its design. If I had my druthers, again, I'd take that off. And I don't think we'd have that problem. We wouldn't have a problem whatsoever. I have seen this knife fail a couple times from a couple users online. And it tends to break right in the hilt or right back here in the handle. And it always seems to happen in colder weather. I've never seen this knife fail in warmer weather. So, I don't know. Everybody can draw their own conclusions. Yeah, just remember that as you go into the field, what knives are intended to do. Yes, they're intended to do division. We all know that, but it's, you know, what kind of division are you doing? So when I was doing my, I have baton this through oak, maple, cedar, what else? A few different types of woods, and some semi-hard and some soft like a pine. And what I've noticed is that the knife does a fairly good job due to this rubber overmold of absorbing shock, much better than something like the RTAC does, which transfers a lot of that straight down the spine, right into the micarta handle. There's really no absorption whatsoever. That is
my tabletop review of Dirty Diana.
And you guys, if you don't have one and you haven't had one, read some of the reviews. Check out some of the other reviews online. This is a great knife that performs very well in a wilderness, an outdoor slash survival knife capacity. So highly recommended on the Franchise Chronicles. You guys will see it in further use because this is going to be making a lot of trips with me, a lot of day trips, etc. And there you have it, Franchise Kids review of Dirty Diana, the Cold Steel Recon Scout. Peace be with you. Thanks for coming along as always. Franchise Kid, out.
Prestige.